The traditional approach to the reconstruction of head and neck defects is based on the concept of the reconstructive ladder. The basic notion is to use the simplest approach to solving a reconstructive problem before advancing up the ladder to a more complex technique. Local or regional flaps, free flaps, perforator flaps, all these wide reconstructive possibilities which are available nowadays can proceed of centuries of human scientific and cultural evolution. We can find the first plastic techniques in documents as ancient as the Egyptian papyruses. Egyptian doctors are considered to be the most ancient predecessors of the plastic surgery. In Edwin Smith papyrus, there are guarded the first items of treatment of facial trauma like jaw and nasal fractures. However, we can find the first record of reconstructive surgery in India. In that time, the acts of facial mutilation, and especially the nose, were commonly inflicted by criminals, and also they were an habitual practice of the Indian justice, in which certain offenses as the infidelity were punished in that bloody way. Sushruta is considered as the founding father of surgery. His Samhita or Encyclopedia is one of the oldest known surgical texts, and it describes in detail interventions for the nasal reconstruction using flaps from the forehead, which are the base of the current techniques. In that time, the first skin graft would also describe for nasal reconstruction 2000 years before the first official cutaneous graft. The Romans also performed some plastic surgeries. For religious reasons, they didn't dissect either human beings nor animals, so the knowledge was based completely on the test of Greek predecessors. Nevertheless, Cornelius Celsus left us some accurate anatomical descriptions. The fall of the Roman Empire in the 5th century and the subsequent extension of the barbarian tribes provoked an unfortunate stop in the development of the reconstructive surgery. Christianity also stopped the advances in this area. The practice of the medicine turned into an ethereal experience that any contact with the patient should be avoided. The manual work needed to carry out operations was considered to be dishonorable. Surgeons' barbers still worsened the reputation of the surgery. With no formal training, they generally had a bad reputation that won't improve until the development of academic surgery as a specialty of medicine. However, it's possible to find some example of reconstructive surgery, as the practice to the Emperor Justinian II in 700 BC, whose nose was reconstructed by a frontal flap. In the 14th century, science were reborn, and with them, surgery. The reconstructive Indian principles was transmitted to the Islam by the invasion of the India in the 10th century. The nose received great attention from first surgeons. One of the first procedures for reconstructing the nose is attributed to a surgeon called Antonio Branca in Sicily, who reintroduced the Indum method, modifying it using a skin flap from the arm. In that time coexisted three methods for nasal reconstruction. The Indian one that turned down a flap from the forehead, the French method which consists in sliding flaps taken from the neighboring tissues of the face, and the Italian method which took a flap from the arm or forearm. Unfortunately, it was not until nearly a century later, after Antonius Branca's death, when Gasparo Tagliacozzi spread this technique among European surgeons. Tagliacozzi was a key link in the transformation of the barber's surgery in a scientific specialty. However, at the end of the 16th century, Europe enters in a new stage of cultural decadence, superstition, and scientific ignorance. Plastic surgery has to wait until the late 18th century for the first significant advance in the history of plastic surgery, the skin graft, a procedure first described in ancient India many centuries ago. This reappearance was attributed to a simple letter of a British Army surgeon called Lucas and published by the magazine Gentleman's Magazine in 1794. On it, Lucas described the nasal reconstruction of an English trucker whose nose was amputated in India as punishment for transporting supplies to the British forces during the colonized years. Like in many other cases in the history of medicine, a specific fact like Lucas' famous letter re-stimulated the interest for the reconstructive surgery. In 17th in Europe, the widespread of the syphilis contributed the advance of the reconstructive surgery. Loss of nose in syphilis patients was so stigmatizing that many patients were willing to undergo surgery without anesthetic, in an effort to repair the damage. Ambroise Paré, a 16th century French surgeon, published in 1564 the earliest principles of reconstructive surgery. However, until the Industrial Revolution, surgeons were incapable of overcoming the three principal obstacles to the progression of the reconstructive techniques: bleeding, pain, and infection. Advances in these fields transformed surgery from a risky job into a scientific discipline capable of treating many diseases. Advances in anesthesia, the introduction of sterile techniques, and the discovery of antibiotics were another big steps in making possible an elective surgery. The parents of modern plastic surgery, like von Graef, Diefenbach, Chopard, Trippier, von Bureau, Slander, or Robert Abe, described local flaps for face reconstruction without even good knowledge of their anatomy and vascularization. Sir Ashley Cooper carried out the first cutaneous graft in 1817, using a skin from an amputated member to cover the stump. But it was the invention of the dermatome by Paget in 1939 that revolutionized this technique and turned it into an essential element in the therapeutic arsenal of any reconstructive surgeon. Despite of the enormous development of reconstructive anesthetic procedures during the 19th century, the specialty didn't exist as such. Almost no surgeon was exclusively dedicated to this discipline because it was not considered to be a priority and it wasn't dedicated to save lives. But all has changed with the outbreak of the First World War.
Thank you.
The Great War was the crucial point where the importance of maxillofacial surgery begins to be recognized. The development of firearms brought on a high incidence of craniofacial injuries, and with it, an accelerated advance in the development and refinement of the surgical techniques. In addition, it forced the creation of specialized centers both in Europe and in the United States. From these centers emerged the parents of many of the techniques that we use nowadays. In the United States, Wilray Papin Blair is recognized by many as the premier American pioneer in plastic surgery. In 1912, he wrote Surgery and Disease of the Mouth and Jaws, the first comprehensive publication on the treatment of oral and maxillofacial disease in the United States. When the United States entered the First World War, Blair was chosen to lead surgeons in the treatment of craniofacial injuries caused by the trench warfare. However, it is considered that the father of modern plastic surgery was Sir Harold Gillis. He was a New Zealand otolaryngologist who developed many of the techniques in the treatment of soldiers with terrible war wounds. Supposed a ray of hope for those disfigured and forced to use a facial mask, and gave them the option to continue with a normal life.
Relying on a nervous experience repeating faces, Gillis and his friend Ralph Millar describe what the commandments of a reconstructive surgeon should be. In the second half of the 20th century, reconstructive surgery grew in an extraordinary way. At the mid-60s, it was thought that the flaps only could be composed of skin and subcutaneous tissue and based on a randomized vascularization. This led to the development of rigid length-to-width ratios for flaps to ensure its viability. A general rule was that the length of skin flaps was not supposed to be greater than 1.5 times its width. Anatomical knowledge of flaps was limited, so they were raised without any consideration of a well-known blood supply. Manchot first and Salmon later in 1939 published pioneering works describing the arteries of the skin. The concept of randomized flaps was properly changed in the 60s, when Milton demonstrated the viability of pieces of skin based on a well-known arteries. Long and narrow skin flaps could be safely raised and based on a known vessel. This led to the MacGregor and Morgan's classification of axial and random pattern skin flaps in the early 70s. Later on, surgery shifted to the introduction of muscle and musculocutaneous flaps. Initially, it was hypothesized that the better vascularization was improved by including the muscle. However, this bigger volume can also lead to a functional or aesthetic problem in the receptor area. Even more, it is difficult to predict the degree of atrophy of the denervated muscle, and therefore the final aesthetic result of the reconstruction. For these reasons, a greater refinement was needed in the reconstructive techniques. Pedicle fasciocutaneous flaps were developed especially during the 80s of the 20th century. By using these flaps, the mobility of the donor area remains limited because there is hardly any loss of function of the muscle. Moreover, these flaps are more pliable and often slimmer than the neocutaneous flaps, and therefore easier to adapt to the donor area. Since the end of the 70s of the last century, the development of the operation microscope and microsurgical instruments, and the even increased knowledge about the vascular anatomy of skin and muscles, all came together. This created the possibility to cut the pedicle of a growing number of axial flaps and to revascularize these flaps with microanastomosis. These three flaps made possible to choose the flap with the best properties, suited for the area that needs reconstruction, but also to choose the flap that causes the least mobility and loss in function in the donor area. Recently, flaps based on perforated vessels have become popular. Vessels proceeding from deep ones that reach the skin, perforating muscles or fascias. They are one more step in the refinement of the reconstructions, allowing the transplant of wide and thin thickness tissues with less mobility in the donor side. Further advances in perforator flap surgery are in permanent evolution, like superficial free flaps, the freestyle free flaps, the chimeric sentinel muscle perforator flaps, or perforator 2 perforator free flaps, are simply the beginning. Based on our last experiences, it is safe to say that we are simply scratching the surface. Over the past decade, facial vascularized composite allotransplantation has reached the place at the top of the reconstructive ladder. In the last years, facial transplantation has emerged as a viable and successful option to restore the appearance and function of patients with severe, devastating facial injuries. Unlike solid organ transplantation, which is potentially life-saving, facial transplantation is life-changing. Face transplantation is a single operation that can restore aesthetic and functional characteristics of the original face, fulfilling the Sir Harold Gillis principle of replacing like with like. According to Proverbs, every future is not far away, but they advise don't try to make predictions, especially those concerning the future. What is true is that we must look to the past to help us move forward in the future. Because about the future of reconstructive surgery, really someone knows?